Listening Library presents Double or Die, The Young James Bond, Book 3, by Charlie Higson. Read for you by Nathaniel Parker. The Hungry Machine. The human brain is a remarkable object. It contains 100 billion neurons, all talking to each other via tiny electrical sparks, like a never-ending fireworks display inside your skull. Your brain weighs 3 pounds. It makes up only 1/50th of your body, yet it uses up over 1/5th of your blood supply and oxygen. The brain is a hungry machine. It never shuts down. Even while you're asleep, it is awake, keeping your lungs breathing, your heart beating, the blood flowing through your veins. Without your brain, you can do nothing. It allows you to ride a bike, read a book, laugh at a joke. It can store a whole lifetime of memories. But it is very fragile. Alexis Fairbairn was painfully aware of this, because there was a pistol pointing at his head, and he knew that if that pistol were fired, all those precious memories that he had been storing up for the last 32 years would be blasted into oblivion. Then his lungs would fall still. His heart would stop pumping. The blood would freeze in his veins, and Alexis Fairbairn would cease to be. The pistol was a 6-shot revolver with a short, stubby barrel. Not very accurate at long range, but deadly enough close up. What made it more deadly was its grip, which doubled as a knuckle duster. The fingers of the man holding it were curled through big brass rings. One punch would shatter a man's jaw. Fairbairn knew that this type of gun was called an Apache, after the vicious street thugs who had carried them in Paris at the end of the last century. Their weapons had also carried blades that swung out and could be used like bayonets. He sometimes thought he knew too much. And even as he stared at the nasty black hole in the gun's nose, he heard a click, followed by a metallic scraping sound, and a 4-inch long spring-loaded stiletto blade slid out from beneath the barrel and snapped into place. Sometimes Fairbairn wished that he could be happy and stupid, blissfully unaware of everything that was going on in the world around him. Sometimes he wished that instead of spending half his life expanding his brain and filling it with facts and figures, he had devoted some of that time to his body. In moments like this, he wished that he had big muscles and quick reflexes. If only he had learned how to disarm a man, he might now be able to grab his attacker's wrist and wrestle the gun out of his hand, maybe even turn it on him. He had read about such things. He knew in theory that it could be done, but he also knew that it would be useless to try. He was weak, and he was timid, and he was clumsy. Now that he thought about it, however, he realized that he wasn't scared. That was interesting. He would have assumed that he would be terrified, but no, all he felt was disappointment, regret that his remarkable brain was soon to be switched off. "Don't try to run or resist in any way," said the gunman, and for the first time Fairbairn looked at him rather than at his gun. He was tall and thin and stooped, with a huge bony head that looked too heavy for his shoulders. His large black eyes were set in deep hollow sockets, and the skin was pulled so tight on his head that it resembled a skull. The gunman was not alone. He had an accomplice, a younger man with a pleasant, unremarkable face. He wouldn't have looked out of place behind the counter in a bank or scribbling away at a ledger in an office. Fairbairn found that it helped to think of him as a clerk rather than as a potential assassin. It made him less threatening.
"You know what will happen if he pulls that trigger," said the clerk with a hint of menace.
The menace was unnecessary. Fairbairn knew exactly what would happen. The hammer of the gun would snap forward and strike the percussion cap at the rear of the bullet casing. This would set off a small explosion, which would propel the shell at 25 feet per second out of its casing and down the barrel, where a long spiral groove would cause it to spin so that it would fly straighter. Finally, it would burst out of the gun, not 6 inches from Fairbairn's forehead. The bullet would be soft-nosed, designed to stop a man. As it hit bone, it would flatten and widen like an opening fist, and then it would tunnel through his head, sucking out any soft matter as it went. A bird sang in a tree nearby. Fairburn knew from its song that it was a chaffinch. He glanced up and saw that it was sitting on the branch of a yew tree. It was a British custom to plant yews and cypresses in graveyards, a custom they had adopted from the Romans. It was also a Roman custom to put flowers on a grave. Fairburn sighed. His brain was full of such a lot of useless information.
"What are you looking at?" said the clerk.
"I'm not looking at anything," said Fairburn. "I'm sorry, I was distracted."
"I would advise you to pay attention."
"Yes, I do apologise," said Fairburn. "But might I ask what exactly it is you want me to do?"
"We would like you to accompany us, Mr. Fairburn," said the gunman.
So they knew his name. This was not a random attack. They must have followed him here. But what did they want? Fairburn thought hard, casting his mind back over the day. What had happened? Who had he met? What had he said that would cause these two men to be here in the middle of Highgate Cemetery, with one holding an Apache to his head? Up until now, it had been a fairly ordinary Saturday. He had followed the same routine that he had been keeping to for the last few weeks. He had driven up to London first thing from Windsor, visited the reading room at the British Museum, then had lunch at his favourite restaurant in Fitzrovia, and finally he had come here to the cemetery, where he had been making sketches and jotting down notes for a book that he was planning to write on eminent Victorian scientists, several of whom were buried here. The last thing he had done was to take a rubbing from a headstone with an interesting inscription. He had forgotten to bring any rubbing paper with him and had been forced to use the back of a letter from his friend, Ivor Peterson. He still took a childlike delight in rubbing the wax over the paper and watching the writing form. He had just finished and was putting the neatly folded letter back into his coat pocket when the men had appeared. They had walked briskly up the path, nodded a friendly greeting, and the next thing he knew, the ugly snout of a pistol was in his face.
Peterson. Of course. This must be to do with him, or more precisely, to do with what Peterson had written about in the letter.
This was to do with the Nemesis project. He realised that he still had the letter in his hand, hidden inside his pocket. Perhaps he could drop it somewhere. It would be some small clue that he had been here, and if anyone read it, they might be able to help him.
Idiot.
It would be meaningless to anyone else, unless somehow he could direct the right person here, someone who could understand what it meant. Good. His mind was working. He squeezed the paper more tightly into the palm of his hand.
"We're going to walk you to your motor car," said the clerk, "calmly and casually, like old friends. Then you will drive my brother and I to our destination. We will advise you of the route along the way. The gun will be trained on you at all times, and if you do not follow our precise instructions, we will not hesitate to shoot you. Another colleague of ours will be following in our own motor car. Is that clear?"
"Perfectly," said Fairburn, treading on one end of a shoelace and feeling it come undone. "But I still don't know what you want of me."
"For now, you don't need to know," said the gunman. "Just walk."
Fairburn took a step and then stopped.
My lace," he said, looking down at his shoe.
"Tie it," said the young man.
"Thank you," said Fairburn.
He crouched down and carefully slipped the piece of folded paper up inside the bottom of his trouser leg. If he dropped it now, it would be easily spotted, but this way he could delay it until the men were distracted again. He straightened up.
"All set,"
he said, as cheerily as he could manage. He glanced around at the cemetery, taking a last look and imprinting the images on his brain. He looked at the statues and crosses and at the gravestones standing beneath the trees, many overgrown and neglected. Then he took his first step, brushing against some low winter foliage, and as he did so, he shook his leg and felt the scrap of paper fall out. He didn't look down to check, but he prayed that it would be lying hidden by the side of the path.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.